Good afternoon. Hi.
Hi.
Welcome. I'm Dolmany Martin. I'm co-director of the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics here at Pitt. And it's a pleasure to introduce Mr. Campbell. Thanks to the Humanity Center for giving us the space and giving us some support to have this event. So I wanted to say that Christian Campbell, I don't know if you even know this, Christian, but you joined us as a part of our first Dream Space Residency program, which is a new program at the center where we host the development of new works by poet scholars, and other artistic practitioners whose work intersects with African American and African diasporic poetry and poetics. Visiting guests are afforded funding, time, and space to do research and think at their leisure, meet and collaborate with one another and Pittsburgh area writers and institutions on new projects. And so Christian's actually been here for a week doing just that. As a part of this week, he spent some time at the archives at the Warhol Museum, which holds an array of Jean-Michel Basquiat's correspondence and photographs and collaborative works between Basquiat and Andy Warhol. And I hear via word of mouth that that was somewhat productive. So I'll just introduce Christian briefly, and he'll present his work. And then there'll be time, obviously, for Q&A. So, and I think there's a short reception after. I don't know what's at this reception. I guess some kind of treats of some sort. In Erasing Basquiat, Christian Campbell looks at the revival of Basquiat's work as social critique within our new moment of racial hatred and the erasure of black bodies. Campbell asks, what has been erased from the criticism, curation, and consumption of Basquiat's global legacy? What might we re-envision in Basquiat's work if we rightfully reframe him as an erasurist? In turn, he implicitly interrogates what emerges via this prism of erasures, what can be seen in its reflective capacities, in a lecture that is itself, I believe, occupying ranging modalities of speech and the critical. Campbell enters the very space of the prism, thereby, in a performative way, articulates the Caribbeanness that I believe he wants to bring forth by talking about Basquiat's erasures. Now I go on to the official bio, and I will edit it a little bit, because there's so much. So Christian Campbell is a Trinidadian Bahamian poet, essayist, and cultural critic who has lived in the Caribbean, the United States, and the UK, and Canada. He is the author of Running the Dusk, 2010, which won the Aldeburgh First Collection Prize, and was also named one of the best books of the year by the Caribbean Review of Books, Horizon Review, and Poetry International. Running the Dusk was recently translated into the Spanish and published in Cuba. Pulitzer Prize-winning poet Yusef Kumanyaka calls Running the Dust, quote, the gutsy work of a long-distance runner who possesses the wit and endurance, the staying power of authentic genius. Campbell's creative and critical work has also been published, featured, or reviewed in the New York Times, The Guardian, Small Axe, Callaloo, The Financial Times, and elsewhere. He has received awards and fellowships from CAAPP, the Avron Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the Lannan Foundation, the Fine Arts Work Center, Redloaf, and elsewhere. He has held faculty and visiting appointments at Franklin and Marshall College, the University of the West Indies, University of Toronto, University of Pennsylvania. Campbell studied at the University of Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar and received his PhD at Duke University. His recent works include a manuscript of poetry in diaspora and a book of essays on visual art, sports, literature, performance, travel, and cultural politics. This book will include a series of essays on Jean-Michel Basquiat, commissioned for major exhibitions in Canada. at the Art Gallery of Ontario, Spain, Guggenheim, Bilbao, in the US, other museums, for which he received the Art Writing Award from the Ontario Association of Art Galleries. So please join me in welcoming Christian Campbell.
It's such an amazing honor to be here. I'm just going to move around a little bit. You'll find that I'm going to kind of operate like a DJ in this reading slash talk. I am full of gratitude, but I'm going to save it for the end. Erasing Basquiat. Furless, older now, his gravelly speaking voice seeming to belong to one person, the famous falsetto to another. In this interview on the FM radio show, The Breakfast Club, Maxwell reminisced with modesty and gratitude about his rise as a 90s idol envoy of so-called neo-soul. But when he spoke of his Caribbean background, he was on edge. Quote, "I look crazy, big old hair and everything, and having the weird West Indian type of thing, that's not typical really for an R&B person. My dad's from Puerto Rico, my mom's from Haiti. I'm first generation from Brooklyn. I didn't feel black enough." I'm going to pull that up. Matsuo continues, "When someone finds out your mom's from Haiti or your dad's Puerto Rican, they're just like, well, you're not really from the South. You get that a lot. It's kind of like even when you go to Puerto Rico, if you can't really speak Spanish, they don't think you're Spanish enough. If you can't speak Creole, you're not Haitian. People have those weird things, especially in the Caribbean. So you know, growing up with that feeling of, well, I hope this is going to be good enough for people." Maxwell's anxiety about belonging and authenticity in both the United States and the Caribbean is deeply familiar, of course. But it is his worry about the consequences of being outed as a Caribbean person that is most instructive. Caribbean identities are, if anything, about ambiguity. Now you see them. Now you don't. For years after he exploded on the scene, few knew that the gifted R&B singer's last name was Rivera, and his first name was Gerald. His stage mononym is his middle name. Few knew that he was the other famous Haitian Puerto Rican Brooklynite. Why did we need to know? Matilde. Mouth open, story jump out. At a recent panel conversation about Haitian Nuyorican American artist Jean-Michel Basquiat at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, an audience member took the five panelists to task for not recognizing Basquiat as Boricua. Quote, "I'm a Puerto Rican man. I'm a gay man. I'm HIV positive. I'm also an artist. When I see Jean-Michel's work, I'm looking to see where do I fit in his work. The reality is that sometimes we talk about his philosophy. We talk about everything, but we forget the actual work. The work speaks by itself. Every time I look at his painting, I actually see the fact that he represents himself in that work. he must have his ethnic side, his Haitian side, but as well, if we actually look at his work, he has Spanish words, he has Spanish language.
Equals ethnic side, so his Boricua side is non-ethnic? What the?
And he continues, even the fact that he used Santeria or Santeros, it's a style of painting where you paint deities and santos and saints. That's actually a traditional Catholic belief, and that was introduced to him by his mother being Puerto Rican. The reality is the panel is not diverse because we forget his actual work speaks about his mother and his father and how those two things created who he was. And I understand the community wants to pigeon him and say he's black, he's black, he's black, end quote. On my live stream feed, I could hear this audience member, but I couldn't see him. The panelists responded graciously by acknowledging the Spanish words and other references in Basquiat's art, as well as the postmodern complexity of blackness beyond phenotype and the centrality of Africanness to the cultural formation of the Americas. They also critiqued the audience members' obvious disavowal of the Africanness of Santeria, to much applause. At the same time, they never really confronted and dealt with their utter lack of engagement with the rich Caribbean diasporic context of Basquiat's work and life. The irony wasn't lost on me, a queer Puerto Rican man of unknown racial background and five black panelists of unknown ethnic and cultural origins, all making important interventions, but still unable to see Basquiat wholly at, of all places, the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, so named for the great Afro-Boricua historian and activist Arturo Alfonso Schomburg. They couldn't see him either.
Footnote 6. As I told my friends, the artist Josefina Baez and the scholar Arturo Victoriano, morphos who believe that Santa Claus is real before they believe that an Afro-Latinx exists. But I digress. See Miriam Jimenez Roman and Juan Flores, editors, the Afro-Latina Reader, History and Culture in the United States.
As I watched the panelists respond and history do its dance, I felt something shift. And just so, the whole theater was a ship rocking on the frantic Atlantic. Everyone splashed, baptized with the ocean's salty mouthwater. Somehow, I was there too, splashed with seawater. No one in the room escaped that sea, whole place swaying, rocking. El fantasma de Juan Flores swooped down, warning everyone of the sharks gathering. Cuidado, 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 cuidado.
Footnote 7. The copy editor suggested that I italicize the Spanish here. Are the italics an othering of the words that are not English, letters bent and in shock, huddled and marked as alien? Or are they speech itself, the warm, home Spanish of his mother's voice, who he will miss forever when she has to go away?
Zoe Saldana emerged from the flooded stage playing her piano in full Nina Simone drag. But the water licked most of that face off, brown ink dribbling down to reveal her actual brown. Zoe Nina began to cry croon four women in Spanish. Dominican Spanish, Puerto Rican Spanish, a mixture of both. Jean-Michel's mother, Matilde, appeared after being doubly disappeared earlier. Matilde, who is nearly Nina's rich chroma, joined in with Zoe, hugging her close enough that Zoe could feel her soft fro against her face. And the panelists swayed from side to side. I'll just stop briefly here to say that this was actually a find from the Warhol Archive. So this is a rare image of Jean-Michel Basquiat's mother, Matilde Basquiat, taken by Andy Warhol. And it's really, really hard to find images just, you know, online or anywhere. There's one, I think, where they're all at dinner, but partly because she struggled with mental illness and was in an asylum for much of Jean-Michel's life. But in a way, I'm contending that to see a clear picture of Jean-Michel Basquiat's mama is to alter art history. Basquiat's art of revelatory cancellation. So in this section, I actually wish I could have shown you the actual clip. It's an infamous interview of Jean-Michel Basquiat with the art historian Mark Miller, but they've taken it down from the internet, so I'm gonna have to act it out for you. Basquiat's art of revelatory cancellation. So you'll see who's, so this is Mark Miller and then Basquiat. Mark Miller. So you're what? Haitian Puerto Rican? I was born here, but my mother's fourth generation Puerto Rican. My father comes from Haiti. You feel that's in your art? Genetically? Genetically or, yeah, I guess so. Culturally? I mean, Haiti is, of course, famous for its art. Yeah, that's why I say genetically, because I've never been there. And I grew up in, you know, a pretty simple American vacuum, television mostly. No Haitian primitives on your wall? At home? Haitian primitives? What do you mean? People? People nailed up on my walls? I mean paintings. No. Just typical prints you'd find in any home in America. Well, some homes in America. But nothing really special. So you wouldn't really attribute any of your work to those roots? Probably the frustration with the way I grew up has something to do with it. What else can be said about Basquiat's infamous interview with art historian Mark Miller? I'm interested here in how irritated Basquiat is by Miller's colonial condescension and awkward ignorance, but also how amused and delighted he is to toy with Miller. Basquiat is in full trickster mode, evading, disavowing, jabbing, hoodwinking, dancing. Like most of us diasporic misfits, Basquiat is all too familiar with the problem of illegibility. So you're, what? And he clearly knows how to navigate it. Basquiat performs immigrant strategies of self-erasure and self-creation that serve to refuse othering and assert power in scenes of subjection. He doesn't say, yes, I'm Haitian Puerto Rican, which is one valid response. Instead, he begins by insisting on US-American birthright, I was born here, and attributes Haitian Puerto Rican to his parents. And then he responds with uncertainty and possibility that his heritage may genetically informed his art, but interrupts this with a negation, never been there, and chooses not to disclose that he has, in fact, lived in Puerto Rico. Basquiat holds a mirror up to Miller, brilliantly exposing the violence of his reductions. Haitian primitives, what do you mean? People nailed up on my walls? With twisted humor and dynamic poetic compression, Basquiat shows how the reckless eyeballing of the Euro-modern construct of primitivism turns complex subjects into Christ figures, rudely nailed into stereotypical place. Like any home in America is a retreat to US-American suburban sameness. To US-American suburban sameness as a shield against Miller's colonial exoticizing, Haitian primitives. A pretty simple American vacuum is even more fascinating given the image of the vacuum cleaner as an artifact of Middle Americana and American vacuum as a void, a white hole emptied of Haitian, Puerto Rican, and by extension, colored difference. Basquiat, who is so hard to pin down or nail up, becomes a Rorschach on his own canvas, a tabula rasa, onto which we can project all our own anxieties and desires. Though a seemingly trivial conversation, this interview dramatizes the kinds of ideological trials Basquiat constantly endured to enter the gates of the gallery. He performs the kinds of strategic erasures that are his governing aesthetic strategies on the canvas. He engages in sous-vature, or under erasure, a literary practice associated with Martin Heidegger and later Jacques Derrida, in which words are crossed out within a text yet remain legible.
Footnote 9. Heidegger and Derrida held, but what the hell, pray tell, could they possibly say to a black Haitian New Yorker in the Reagan age about erasure? Still, see Jacques Derrida of Grammatology, translation, Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak.
Derridian sous-rature is an act of simultaneous recognition and negation that confronts the limits of language. The word under erasure is then at once inadequate and indispensable. Like the sous-rature we see in so many Basquiat paintings, his conversation with Miller could look like this. Basquiat erased. Basquiat is erased. It is a practice that is as violent for him as it is generative. The Basquiat mark is an outtake. He famously said to Robert Farris Thompson, "I cross out words so you will see them more." Thompson offers a brilliantly pithy echo Jean-Michel cancels to reveal. Fellow Caribbean erasurist, poet theorist Nobezi Philip reminds us that living in diaspora marked by violence, terror, captivity, loss, and dispersal requires revelatory cancellation. Echoing Toni Morrison's powerful dictum, "This is not a story to pass on," Nobezi writes, "to not tell the story that must be told." Diaspora disappear. What is diaspora but a site of erasure? Erasure as 60 million, no more. Erasure as the surf which continually wipes the sand clean. Erasure as the split tongue confessing. Erasure as the unsayable must say. Erasure as face, as mask, as dance. Erasure as the migrant gift to conceal. Erasure as American silence. Erasure as defacement. Erasure as creation, erasure as the right to opacity, erasure as the right to change your mind. One of the best known early erasures is Tom Phillips' A Hummerment, and this is an example image from it, a treated Victorian novel. The first edition is from 1970, and it was an altered book in which Phillips used collage, cut-up painting, and other techniques to erase W.H. Mallet's forgotten Victorian novel, A Human Document, from 1892. In A Little White Shadow, from 06, Mary Ruffel used correction fluid to paint out selected words and create new poems. Importantly, what is called literary erasure, the act of erasing an existing text to produce a new one, isn't only literary. It operates at the crossroads between literature and visual art, like Basquiat's work. Robert Rauschenberg famously erased a drawing given to him by de Kooning, with his permission, in Erase de Kooning Drawing, and that's from 1953. I don't have that image, but you could find it anywhere. In 1981, Amina Nose pulled together a group exhibit on the downtown art scene that included Keith Haring, Barbara Kruger, Jenny Holzer, and Basquiat. Holzer went on to create the ongoing series Redaction Paintings in 2005, and here's an example. You know, many of you know it. which reproduces declassified US war documents that have been partially or completely redacted by government censors. One of the more iconic erasure projects of recent years, Holtz's redaction paintings, shows us that erasure is both a governing practice of many artists and a governing practice of the state. How many of you have seen this before, any part of the work? Raise your hand. Okay. What might we revision in Basquiat's work if we rightfully reframe him as an erasurist? Basquiat's painting, his graphics, engenders an art of illusions, and elisions. His visual critique simultaneously tests limits and asks us to think across boundaries. We can and must then at once engage with his fundamentally interdisciplinary practice as literary, visual, and musical, and constantly think through the politics of his aesthetic strategies in the context of his multiplicitous cultural repertoire. Basquiat embodies interdisciplinarity as resourcefulness or even a kind of love, the act of collecting and drawing on anything available in the name of survival. It is the mastery required of all displaced peoples. So the next section is called La mano en el pecho. I survived my Jean year, my Jimmy year, my Janice year, my Kurt year, my Amy year, and I survived my Jesus year. Basquiat died in 1988, but I am alive and writing this. How can we who survived reread a diagram painting like Untitled Hand Anatomy, 1982? Like any good erasurist, Basquiat's language is appropriated, reframed, and often remixed. Much of the text in this painting is sourced from Gray's Anatomy, which he received from his mother as a child while recovering from being hit by a car. As a side note, you know what the interesting thing I didn't know about Andy Warhol is that he was very, very ill as a child, but also he was shot as an adult, and that was a turning point in his career. But also thinking about Frida Kahlo, who experienced a really bad accident, and how that sort of defined her work, that she sort of constantly returned to the primal scene of her own body. And Basquiat shares that with all of them, this thing of, you know, sort of carrying a pain in your body, or experiencing a kind of childhood or early trauma that shapes your life explicitly or implicitly. Texts such as Flexor Digitae, on this side here, Minimi Brevis and Abducted Digitae, Mimini Flexor, you know, we see Basquiat's characteristic misspellings. Flexor Capri is drawn directly from chapter 4 of Gray's Anatomy on Myology, which Basquiat references at the top of the painting, chapter 4. I think it got cut off, unfortunately, sorry. In the section on the muscles and fascia of the hand, Spanish words stand out in the painting. Pecho, chest, labels the heart, and mano labels the hand. So, mano and pecho. As Kelly Jones has brilliantly argued, the Spanish in Basquiat's paintings is often associated with intimacy. Following Jones, I hear pecho and mano in the voice of his mother. I am reminded that while Basquiat's obsession with anatomy is about constantly returning to the primal scene of trauma, it is also about care, tenderness, and healing in moments of vulnerability. The Spanish words also serve to creolize Gray's Anatomy, bringing a disruptive Caribbean energy to a British text of purported universal authority. Basquiat's study of the hand also, of course, references Leonardo da Vinci's famous anatomical studies. though Basquiat's whimsical line offers this mano as both tribute and spoof, making it look more like Thing, the disembodied hand from the Addams Family. Basquiat's unprecious late for the atrium gestural strokes and the diagram's arrows suggest that the mano is in motion, painting, writing, erasing across dimensions. He demonstrates his stylistic fugitivity here. In the middle of the canvas is a white, red, and blue lined figure in a hat. And I'm sorry about the image, but it got cut off so you can't see the hat. Is a white, red, and blue lined figure in a hat that is painted in his meta-primitivist mode. The mano then may belong to that figure that has shape-shifted from meta-primitivist to faux academic as it moves from one space to another. So I'm trying to think about these sort of different dimensions of the paintings and different sort of styles to register movement between dimensions. The mano is also in the process of making an erasure with palimpsestic painting on the right side of the canvas. So this motion here, the sort of white being brung down, being sort of brought down by the hand, is an erasure for me. That is, you know, sort of a characteristic Basquiat move. Basquiat's painting performs the structural complexity, rapid changes, improvisation, and oscillating feels of both bebop, his favorite music, and the polyglots of his household, borough, and countries. Untitled Hand Anatomy is Basquiat's Ars Poetica in the infinitive, making and erasing itself. On my first day in Philadelphia, I broke a bone in my right hand, my writing hand. The diagnosis, non-displaced scaphoid fracture. The scaphoid, from the Greek scaphos, meaning boat, is about the size of a cashew, or a very tiny toy boat. In Untitled Hand Anatomy, you can find the scaphoid in the wrist near the thumb, close to the arrow against the hand, the second worst bone in the body to break, the surgeon said. There was a small erasure on the x-ray for where my bone should have been whole. It still hurts a little to write this. I thought of Basquiat every time I went for x-rays, all the whirring sounds beneath a cloak, like a 1920s photographer, as my boat bone posed for the picture. So we're gonna move to the next section, which is Boricua Burrows. In the triptych Five Fish Species, 1984, which queries and memorializes Basquiat's writer hero, William S. Burroughs, I am forced to play guessing games to read the words with their scratched out letters. Near the bottom of the left panel, there is a sentence appropriated from Burroughs' famous novel, The Salt Machine, from 1961. He is subject to take back the keys to the shit house. The original sentence from Burroughs reads, he is subject to take back the keys of the shit house. Basquiat's version, and we have to note the question marks that he has. Basquiat's version is full of scratched out letters and sounds like a bewildered echo and slight mishearing in response to Burroughs' statement, as if they are trying to speak to each other, but Burroughs is inside the house and Basquiat is outside in the yard. Even more interesting than the quote's meaning is the nature of Basquiat's remix. The scratches, like a DJ scratching a record, indicate conceptual and sonic revision. Remix, Basquiat's fascinating use of the inverted question mark of Spanish grammar, suggests that he creolizes and ventriloquizes Burroughs, making the beat writer speak with a Boricua accent. He makes Burroughs speak like his mother. In the third panel, Basquiat continues his obsession with anatomy and represents Burroughs as a Picasso-like skull had labeled cerebrum. I mean, I want to stop there and say, the skull head could be Picasso-like, but it could also be Haitian Vodou-like. There's an incredible diasporic simultaneity in his iconography. And he labels it cerebrum, or perhaps cerebro, alchemy, and side view of jaw. Burroughs was a pioneer of the cut-up technique, the act of cutting up and rearranging an existing text to create a new one, which is certainly kin to the aleatoric strategies of both erasure and bebop. It is worth noting that the etymology of anatomy is, in fact, cut up from the Greek anatome, dissection, from ana, meaning up, and temnin, meaning to cut. Like the cut-up technique, anatomy and anatomical diagrams offer Basquiat compositional strategies that he can appropriate and interrupt to bend or break form and to confront personal and collective traumas. In Basquiat's oeuvre, we witness the diagrammatic as a mode of relation within a constellation of objects and a mode of gestural gestalt. His obsession with anatomy suggests processes of dissection and fragmentation, but also the possibility of recombination, like dry bones in the valley, collecting themselves on command. So as many of you know, Basquiat is deeply engaged with a number of African-American cultural forms and sort of heroic figures, especially boxing and jazz. And I have a section where I'm looking at the paintings, Jack Johnson, and the piece Now's the Time, which is a sculpture in the shape of a record. But I wanted to, since I have this wonderful intellectual community, to challenge myself and actually to kind of, in front of you, work through a reading that I'm trying to work out. I don't have worked out fully. So this section is called Live Black Matter. And this piece, which many of you know, is his 1981 painting, Irony of a Negro Policeman. So this painting is interesting for a number of reasons, not least of which one of the many ways in which I would characterize this moment as a kind of Basquiat revival is also the ways in which his paintings, particularly this one, have become movement memes, particularly for Black Lives Matter, right? In the wake of police terrorism and extermination of Black people in this country, right? So there's a reading that a number of critics have put out there that is clear to us, that it is it's sort of a painting that has to do with betrayal, with Black complicity, with a kind of sellout figure. Becoming, an agent of the very system that destroys you, and so on, in the context of U.S. racism, right? But there's another reading that I want to get to that I'm working on, and I just want to show you another image as well, the original image, actually. So speaking of erasure, this is what it originally looked like. This, I think he painted this in the basement of Onina Nose's gallery in 1881. And you can see the choices that he's made here in deciding to kind of erase that red and sever the body of the policeman. So not only is this skull figure, kind of in shock by his betrayal, but his very body is betraying itself, right? But there's something interesting about another kind of erasure that happens in the text, right? So here we see this kind of ambiguous phrase that looks like paw, left paw, the kind of anatomical labeling that he's known for and you've seen in the previous painting, but also it looks like it could be pawn, right? And then up there it says irony of a Negro policeman, but he does this thing, this erasure practice of disemboweling the word in some ways, taking out most of the vowels, but it could be policeman, but it could also be placement, right? And for me, this irony of Negro placement kind of alludes to the violence of diaspora as well, right? So the reading that I don't think anyone has ever offered of this painting, but I want to offer is that I think that this painting is actually also of a tonton makout, a Haitian tonton makout. So a tonton makout is, let me show you in images. So was a kind of paramilitary force who was created and assembled by Papadoc Duvalier in, I think, about in the late 50s to sort of, I mean, they carried out unspeakable violence and they sustained his dictatorship through a kind of fear. And they often wore these skull-like masks like the Loi or the Gede God, you know, the God of Death, to, you know, create this image of fear. And for me, the mask is also a kind of erasure. It's a totaling of identity, right? So I really want us to think about them, partly because there's in the scholarship, there's been a lot of disavowal of his relationship to Haiti, partly because his father was this kind of bourgeois, you know, Robert Farris Thompson says, you know, he was a smashing tennis player, you know, he's an accountant from an elite family, but he was also an exile. He was exiled by the Duvalier dictatorship, and his brother was actually killed. He doesn't say, but I wonder, and I suspect if that his brother was killed by Tonton Makout. So this is the kind of, I mean, you know, when you have exiles, there's an incredible silence around this trauma, but someone as brilliant and inquisitive and hardworking as Basquiat, you think he wouldn't be curious about this narrative that affects his family and his very creation, right? The other thing that I want to speculate about this image is that at the very moment that we were mourning and fighting the police obliteration of young black people in the US was a moment in which the Dominican Republic the courts put down what's called La Sentencia, basically stripping Dominicans of Haitian descent of citizenship. So there's a way in which, and then, so that was 2013, and I think in 2014, people started to be deported across the border. So this, I don't have those images, but for some reason, this image, you know, kind of also is put in the service of not only a certain kind of complicity, black diaspora complicity and betrayal in the US, but also I think in Hispaniola between the Dominican Republic and Haiti. And I really want to push this reading and get us to think about the way that, you know, Basquiat's at once-ness, his simultaneity offers a kind of visual critique that urges us to think multiple places at once, right? Okay. So the final section, the final reading, it continues. The art of losing. Man dies. In 88, I was a boy on an island. I was alive. Prince was alive. Warhol was dead. some ghosts won't be repelled. In 88, Basquiat painted in pain. Eroica 1 and Eroica 2 are haunted canvases. This is Eroica 2. He pays homage to Cy Twombly, another major erasurist and a great painter of opacity. The list poems or incantations or reverbing dub tracks on these paintings are drawn from a dictionary of African American slang, one of his many languages, but not a language native to his household. But why turn to the dictionary when you are mourning? Perhaps because he has lost his words. Like the medical textbook, the dictionary is a master text that Basquiat both deconstructs and adores. Nearly all of the words on the canvas are B words. What he is really looking for in the dictionary is himself. What do I mean? Both paintings are made by erasures, Twombly-esque ghostings, and you can see, you know, you can see that happening. Twombly-esque ghostings with white paint. In Eroica, actually this is Eroica 1, sorry. There is a painted over dollar sign and a word that could be hybrid is obscured, so we only see half a B and R-I-D. Basquiat rewrites and refuses certain scripts because the inscrutable is a virtue in both Basquiat's oeuvre and Twombly's oeuvre, as well as masquerade cultures throughout the Black diaspora. Then I must respect what is a mystery. Man dies, man dies, man dies, man dies. Erasure, we are reminded, is an art of losing. The art of losing is not too hard to master. Though it may look like, write it, like disaster. How unsettled and comforted I am by all that is lost in these paintings. I know there are rivers of script and hieroglyphs and scratches and ghosts running beneath the visible surfaces. Somewhere I know there is underwriting and unwriting, so much to see that I will never see. And this is the final section. And it's called Reinventing the Wheel of Fortune. Wheel of Fortune! Dun, 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 dun. Vanna White, Goddess Fortuna, poses and smiles. Pat Sajak. This is Pat Sajak speaking. Jean-Michel, the category tonight is thing. If you solve the puzzle, the prize is an all-expenses-paid vacation to Haiti and Puerto Rico and clearance to transcend your race. Woohoo! Jean spins the wheel. And we end here. Thank you.
Thank you for that wonderful talk. I'm going to actually let Christian facilitate the kind of conversation, but I want to invite you to ask questions, to make comments, give answers. You don't actually have to ask questions, which is
good. I would love that.
Yeah, and one of the reasons that we invite people to come to the Center of African American Poetry and Poetics at a kind of critical stage in their work is to get this kind of conversational aspect happening that will hopefully help them further their work. So I'm sure you welcome answers as much as questions. So.
Absolutely.
Thanks.
I would love to have a conversation. Yes.
Thank you for that talk. I was thinking about, first of all, Everett's novel, Erasure, and he tells the story of the Rauschenberg and de Kooning. But he tells many other things as well that are quite relevant to your talk. Are you thinking about this novel at all, or are you familiar with it?
Not really. I know of it. I don't know it that well. But, I mean, thank you for recommending it. I mean, I definitely am going to check it out. I wasn't really thinking of Everett. Yeah. How do you think it'll connect? I mean, other than the obvious, you know, sort of covering, you know, dealing with some of the people in Basquiat's kind of hagiography, like Rauschenberg.
I That would be a long conversation because the novel is so about everything that you just talked about. So, I mean, it's
perfect.
So I wouldn't want to frame how I predict you would respond
right,
to the novel.
Right, sure. But you're just saying I should check it out.
Absolutely.
That's what I'm saying. I kind of want to know what people, what did you, for your trip and transcend, you know, clearance to transcend your race, what did you guess? Everybody's scared to say. Yeah.
I don't have an answer to that, but I have a question.
Sure.
Do you want people to want to wait?
No. Please.
So I wanted to, I'll keep thinking about this, but I wanted to know if you could talk a little bit more about the section where it was the irony of a black police officer.
Irony of a Negro police officer.
Okay, great. So you mentioned that you were like trying to think of that in relationship to contemporary moments or instantiations of anti-black violence. So
diasporically.
So I wanted you to think a little bit more about that, and then also to follow up on your invitation to like help you read it. When you first put up the image, I read it as the first thing that comes to my mind is probably because of my own stuff that I'm working on. Is irony of a Negro problem? Because there's similar letters in there. So
yeah.
That's good.
You're talking about, you know, Du Bois.
We're talking about like the period or the rhetoric or the discourse about the Negro problem, which is very much kind of an irony. Like it's white people's problem, not the Negro's problem.
Right.
And yet it's so constructed as if it's our problem, it's actually their problem.
Right.
So that's just a lot.
A comment. But when you, I mean, is there something specific about anti black violence?
Well, you just said I just wanted to hear a little bit more about how you're thinking of that image in relationship to, because you mentioned it, that you are thinking about it in
Absolutely.
Relationship. So I just wanted to hear
Absolutely.
A little bit more about how you're Why don't
I
it.
Pull it up? Right, so I mean, one of the things that, as I said earlier, is that you know, I think Basquiat's imagery, his graphics, but also his text, really pushes us to think about relation as an ethics. Because his, you know, his allusions go in all directions across geopolitical spaces and so on. I'm interested in, what I want to say earlier that I forgot to say is that this painting actually anticipated another painting that's specifically to do with police brutality that I should have brought called Defacimento, the Death of Michael Stewart. So a number of you know that a friend of his who is a well-known graffiti artist was beaten by the police and beaten to death by the police. And that was, I think, about 1983. And actually, a colleague of mine, Chedra Lebouvier, has a project around this one painting. So she brought the painting to Williams College and had a number of events around it and also taught a class around it. And so this painting anticipates that. So there's a relationship, you know, in thinking about police brutality explicitly. But in some ways, what I want to do is to be able to read, you know, irony of a Negro policeman and then read it as irony of a Negro policeman. And what does that do for how we see the imagery? And I think that what I'm pushing for is for us to really politically, or what I think the painting is pushing for us, is to make connections between anti-black violence across national borders, right? That are happening concurrently and how we can think through. You know, the other thing that's really interesting that I've been thinking about as well is that Basquiat's countries are intimately connected politically the United States around questions of anti-black violence and empire. The United States, Haiti, and Puerto Rico. You know, Haiti and Puerto Rico, in a stereotypical way, are almost seen as, you know, polar opposites to the Caribbean. As, you know, one is revolutionary, the other one is totally colonial, with Puerto Rico being a colony, but it's not as simple as that at all. And I think what's interesting as well is that both Puerto Rico and Haiti, even though we don't talk about it enough, are deeply impacted by US empire, deeply. I mean, Puerto Rico is on the brink of collapse right now. And then we know what's going on in Haiti and how the US is operating in that space. So there's something in the kind of masking that happens in the erasure. There's a polysemy or a duplicity or a simultaneity that I think raises serious ethical and political questions for us. So, thank you. Yes.
Thank you. That was really wonderful.
Thank you very much.
I guess I have a question that maybe a couple of us. I'll say the thoughts first. These might be very obvious, but I was thinking about erasure. Also in terms of the play between iconoplasm and iconophilia, and so thinking about the destruction of the image, not just as sort of like desecration, but also as a kind of spiritualism itself.
Absolutely.
And so how that might reflect sort of the idea of sort of sacred images. And then maybe...
Hold on a second. Yeah. Can you... So you said not only desecration, but also...
Also kind of as a sacred act. So
right.
Recently, like, the destruction of like Byzantine bas reliefs was also an act of getting rid of icons, of religious
right.
icons that are seen as sort of, you know, elevating the deity to, like, you know, a human figure. And so there's something significant, and this I'm poaching from a Franz comment that I was told the other day, there's something significant not just in full erasure, but leaving specific focal absences, because those draw the attention.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, so I thought that was really powerful. The other thing I was thinking about in terms of erasure is in the sort of contemporary split between street art and graffiti is often articulated along racial lines. So street art is more acceptable because it's an image based and it's playful, but
right.
also demographically, a lot of the time, it's elevating sort of these white men to celebrity status and sort of aligning the history of both graffiti and street art that involve people of color.
Right.
So those are just the thoughts. And then I guess I do have a question about what you think about the relationship between iconophilia and iconoclasm.
Well, I mean, I think that I'm trying to think about erasure in this piece. I think that Basquiat actually pushes me to think about erasure in contradictory ways. You know what's really fascinating? I mean, and this is not in visual art, I was thinking about this. The erasure in US contemporary poetry right now is, you know, it's quite hot, it's quite en vogue, but poets of color get erased in conversations about erasure, right? And I think that, you know, part of what I'm trying to also do and I'm pushed to do is to think about erasure as not just this one kind of narrow practice that happens in a mainstream American literary context, but it happens, you know, it happens in masquerade cultures throughout the African diaspora and so on and so forth. So I think that erasure means many different things, and then when we talk about migration, you know, that erasure is both violent and an act of resistance at the same time, and pleasurable, right? This totaling of one's identity, right? I think it sort of reminds me of an interview with Dawn where she asked, who's avant-garde? You know, that these practices that we have to totally rethink, you know, whenever I think about, you know, language poetry's sort of posture is radical, I think about, we've kind of been doing that already, you know what I mean? And your second question was about,
it was more of a comment, and so...
About graffiti and street art.
Yeah.
Oh, this is what I was going to say. So you know, the fascinating thing is that I just finished through my wonderful residency. I just finished final edits for another catalog essay on Basquiat for a wonderful show at the Barbican in London in the fall. So if you get to London, strongly recommend an amazing show about his archives called Boom for Real. And believe it or not, this is, according to the curator, my friend Ellen O'Neill, the first catalog essay specifically on Seymour, on Basquiat's Seymour graffiti. And part of the reason to sort of connect to the racial politics of classifying and these particular disciplines, part of the reason is that Basquiat himself, once he got into the gallery, had a moment of disavowing Seymour and disavowing graffiti. There's a famous quote people bring up, is that, you know, he says, the graffiti has nothing to do with what I do, I'm a painter, right? And I think that because he's so grossly reduced by the kind of savage savant image, which we have to be honest, he sometimes played very well that image, that a lot of us that really care about his legacy have basically scattered like insects, you know, when the graffiti question comes up, because I think it's easy for people to reduce him and say, oh, you know, that cool graffiti artist, which is what happens. And I think we're in a moment now where we're sort of trying to recuperate his art historical significance. I mean, he's deeply erudite, as one can see if we look properly. But I disagree. So you have a lot of curators who say, oh, it's not graffiti, but it's not true. What he was doing, his partner in Seymour, Al Diaz, I interviewed him in New York a couple months ago, and Al was a well-known graph artist by the time they got together. They're teenagers. Basquiat wasn't, but what they were doing was graffiti, even though it's also poetry, right? I mean, that's part of why I was asked, they wanted a poet to read it. But it was graffiti, but Basquiat's very savvy, you know, so he understood, and he was deeply ambitious, and he planned all of this. He understood how in a moment of wild transition in the art world and the art market, that graffiti could get him into the door, but once he was in the door, he had to disavow graffiti in order to remain there, right? Because he sort of saw, he saw that graffiti's time was limited, right? In a moment when the art market was sort of tiring of the coolness of conceptualism and the kind of apex. So thank you very much for that question.
Could you go to the other police image?
It's okay.
The like red and blue one?
Oh boy. I think. The original.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is just another like comment or thought that helps you process. But when I saw this, like the colors like stood out to me in terms of red and blue, and I thought of immediately of like Bloods and Crips and gang violence, and kind of how gangs kind of double as like a problem in like black communities, but also they act as like a policing as well. It's like, or a system where they give people sort of employment and like have protection to a certain degree. And also the idea of kind of liberation of identity, because then you get like new names and new, like a new name when you're in the gang, or you're associated with a new identity.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And obviously the flag too, right? The US flag. But yeah, thank you for that. I didn't think about that at all.
Continuing with the reference to religion and kind of spirituality also being tied up in the destruction of images, when I see this image in particular and I see the staff that the figure is holding.
Yeah.
It looks like a Yoruba traditional religion talking staff.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a staff that's held by the obe or the religious leader or king when he's talking. It often looks like a bird and takes on that form.
That's
and passing that staff from one obey to the other, or passing it from one member of the royal family in that tradition of Orisha to another, often means that you're passing the right to speak in knowledge or knowing something.
Yeah.
But this is also kind of at odds, because when you think of the diaspora context of what we know about Haiti, Puerto Rico, the narrative of the Congolese and the Ewe diasporas from Africa, West Africa, kind of disappeared because it's not that well documented.
Mm.
But in Cities of the Dead by Joseph Roach,
mm.
he talks about the act in Ewe as well as Congolese cultures of actually breaking the things that belong to people who have passed away.
Mm.
And it's a kind of erasure, one that's supposed to help express the grief of those who have lost, but it's also supposed to preserve and hide away and kind of encapsulate the dimension in which that person will remain with their things.
Right.
So kind of having this like provenance of where it's actually like the idea of erasing through the destruction of the item and burial rituals,
mm-hmm.
which is like a kind of erasure,
mm-hmm.
is a way of preserving something,
mm-hmm.
right? So in a way of taking it from the sight or taking it from the palate or the senses is a way to preserve it or to save it in like African diaspora and religious artistic context.
Mm, thank you very much for that. I mean, Yoruba iconography is like all over his work and his oeuvre. But I was thinking, as you were saying, you know, this thing about the I think that Basquiat's art requires a kind of cognitive dissonance that's dramatized in the act of looking, right, at these images. And so there's a part of his power is that you gather a room of us and we see so many different things, and I think things that are our intention. So I think you're exactly right, Jessica, to sort of call on all of this West African imagery in it, and you know, through the Vodun imagery and otherwise, right? Because he's also, you know, his favorite book was Flash of the Spirit, Robert Ferris Thompson, right? It's Basquiat's favorite text. But at the same time, you know, it's for other people, I think older generation, you know, black artists, for instance, some of these strike as caricatures. And there's something Fanonian in, you know, Basquiat was a wrecking ball of reckless eyeballing. So there's this Fanonian thing that happens where he is sort of flinging back, you know, at racist and imperial visioning, like what is assumed, what you want to see. At the same time, he is, you know, marking something that is claimed by the black diaspora through this kind of religious and spiritual iconography. And I think all of that is happening at the same time. So that's another way that I'm, and you're helping me to think about the kind of simultaneity of these images. Yes.
I actually wanted to ask a question about the Bebop.
Oh.
But first, just a comment, if you compare the two paintings side by side, and this is a little bit about the tensions that you were just mentioning. It's interesting that there's much less of the blue sort of on the outside. This may just be too obvious, but on the outside in the erased version, if you look at the first one as the blue with the black sort of dominating,
yeah,
as if the blue is kind of, the irony would be erasing the blackness, but not succeeding, attempting, the purpose of it is to kind of put somebody in this official mass, but it's not working. And then over here, even less the erasure is erasing the erasure of the blue.
Mm.
I mean, there's still a little bit, but not so much. You know?
The blue and the actually, as you call this up, I forgot to talk about also the genitalia.
Yeah. Yeah.
That, I mean, I think that's so significant. I mean, that this painting is also this emasculation or eradication of sexuality and so on and so on. Thank you. But you had a question about people.
Yeah, well, I was interested in your talk about the different reductions and in the thinking back to the Miller conversation.
Yes.
I think it was, think it was Miles Davis who complained that, the very label bebop was just that something that white people made up and they had to be classifying. And you know, I think there, I just wondered if the if there was any questioning of that label or.
Not by Basquiat.
I'm a complete, you know, sort of outside of Basquiat, so I'm.
No, but that's that's a great question. I mean, it sort of goes back to this earlier question by the Lason that you raised about classifying the politics of classification. It's completely relevant, but I've never heard or read anything about Basquiat's, you know, dismissal of bebop as a. As a genre, as a title, as a name, is his favorite music. I mean, Charlie Parker.
Right.
He has multiple pieces where he memorializes Charlie Parker.
And now's the time.
Now's the time. Exactly. Now's the time is a memorial for Charlie Parker. But I mean, it's you know, and he also made music, as a number of you know, in this band. With Michael Holman and others called Gray. So he was deeply, deeply interdisciplinary. And I think that was characteristic of the downtown scene. And also, you know, whatever you think about him, I know Holman himself, in a conversation I had with him, recognizes the influence of Warhol. That this discipline, you know, this deep, you know, or freedom of movement between. You know, painting and sculpture and music and writing and so on and so on. But I think bebop, you know, for him was completely an aesthetic model. You know, the kind of oscillations, the stylistic, the sonic oscillations are, I think, he's interested in dramatizing that in imagery, right? Thank you. Yes.
Hi, thanks so much for these really good close readings on these pieces. This may be too obvious, but...
Nothing is too obvious.
Okay. You spoke a lot about the layering of these different like visual discourses of medical and maybe anatomical ways of perceiving the body. I was curious, too, though, if you could talk a little bit about like the cartographic kind of visual language that he uses. By that I mean, you know, the sense of mapping that's created through the kind of gestural strokes that are created, but also in this, you know, side-by-side comparison, I feel like I'm looking at a map just as much as I am looking at maybe a person or a group's psychology or something. And maybe this is just me, but whenever I look at Basquiat's pieces, I feel like I'm in this weird space where I'm looking at an X-ray and a map kind of simultaneously.
Absolutely.
Like the sense of space is just like boggling in these pieces. So I was just curious, you know, since your research is so attentive to questions of space and place and perhaps placelessness, what you had to think about the cartographic in his pieces.
No, I think that's incredibly rich. Thank you. I think that you know, one of the things I talked about in I think it was this piece and another and hand anatomy, the you know, the diagrammatic. So I think the cartographic sort of falls into that strategy or genre for him. I think when I like that you brought up the map partly because, you know, he embodies a kind of displacement and an inscrutability that is ethnic and geopolitical. So absolutely the map is, you know, sort of a part of his iconography. I think one rich way for us to think about the map as I, you know, talked about this thing of the cognitive dissonance required is, you know, there's a, Basquiat is a trickster in every way. I mean, that there's a kind of aesthetic decoy or tricksterness
in the ways that his paintings sort of look chaotic and elegant at once, you know? So that kind of schema, I think that the schema of the map or the schema of the diagram help him to be very rigorous formally, but to also offer the kind of improvisatory impulses of something like bebop in the context of a frame like a map or a diagram. So that's part of how I think about what, you know, spatially, how he's thinking about it. And the other thing is that his composition, right? That he was so incredibly disciplined about composition and the sort of weightedness of colors and how they relate to each other in different frames, this sense of balance. And that's part of why they have this elegance and chaos at once. Thank you. Yes.
I actually just want to say that I love the presentation of your talk.
Thank you.
And you're bringing in different modes of attending to this work in a way that refuses to kind of reduce it.
Thank you.
And, you know, you kind of decolonize my own reading practice as you gave me a draft before, you know, a couple of days ago, and I was reading it, and I was kind of, you know, in this one mode of reading, you know, towards some kind of a recognizable argument that I would be able to make at the end about the relationship between the erasure of identity and then the performance of erasure in the work, and you refuse to give me that. In the written part, but also in the performance, I think here too, in a way, kind of reflecting, you know, back at us, the workings of the paintings in the way that you gave the talk, which I really love.
Oh, thank you. I really, really appreciate that. Thank you very much. You know, I had a really wonderful conversation with Jessica on, you did a, I guess, CAAPP's first Facebook Live interview. It was a really rich conversation. And she was asking me about a previous essay that's in the Now's the Time catalog. And I actually end that essay with an email to Basquiat from me. And it's like, so it's a letter and email to him. And so there's a way in which that I am, I'm interested in this erotics of art, you know, to go back to Susan Sontag and that famous essay. And I'm interested in intimacy, you know, so because I think that I recognize the deep limits of different kinds of discourses. And I want to get close. I feel like there is so much in the way of seeing this work. So I'm trying to get close. I'm trying to touch it. So that's part of my oscillations and my movement. But it's also, I think, Basquiat himself giving me complete permission, you know, to sort of embody the ways in which intellectual engagement can be outrageous, and it can be personal, and it can be, and it, in fact, it demands that we be imaginative as well. And that's, you know, my work. That's the project of these hybrid essays. Thank you.
I think that's all we have time for, everyone. Thank you
again. Thank you. I just want to take a minute, and I know, like, everybody, like, nobody wanted to take that up, but you have to tell me what you thought. You have to. But before I leave, I want to say deepest thanks to all of you for this intellectual community and space. I really appreciate it. I want to thank the Humanities Center. I want to thank the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics, Terrence Hayes, who is missed. I want to thank Lauren Russell for everything, Jessica for everything, David, who I'm just meeting, I know that you contributed. Yona. Yona brought me 2 cases of water, okay? CAAPP wasn't letting me get poison in Pittsburgh, right? I have 2 cases of bottled water from Yona. I just want you to know that. Thanks to Shalini. Thank you to Autumn and to Angie. So many people, there are more people to thank, but I'm really grateful for this wonderful experience, and you know, deepest thanks to my friend Dawn Lindy Martin. And we gotta clap for her because her vision is so dope. This space is incredible. And yeah, I just think you need to. You deserve the applause. So thank you, and you all are gonna tell me what you guessed when we get out there.